Hi, I'm Akhil Bansal. I'm Deputy CEO for KPMG in India, and I have a privilege of having a discussion with a very accomplished banker, Chairman, Punjab National Bank, Mr. Sunil Mehta. He has his own financial company called SPN Capital, and his vast experience being in State Bank of India, AIG, Citibank, it's over decades accumulated experience of banking. Of course, he was also the chairman of the committee set up by the government on the stress assets, and all those recommendations were accepted by the government. Thank you for this lovely discussion. Mr. Mehta, what we want to talk about is, what is required in India at this moment. If we look at India, it is on a very sensitive juncture at this moment. We have got the right platform. We have really moved well in last few years. But if we do not continue to move in the right direction, there are still many challenges which can pull us down deep south and not go up north. Whether we talk about on a positive, whether it is demographic dividend, whether it is the market, which is a huge market we have in India. But on the other side, lack of infrastructure, we talk about labor laws, we talk about judicial system, which does not work. What would you suggest that India should do in next 3 to 5 years?
So, you're absolutely right. This is really the most important period for the country, and we are at a crossroad. Either we sort of move ahead with a great degree of determination to overcome some of the obstacles that have bedeviled our growth. There's no reason for us not to have a 7 to 8% GDP growth on a sustainable basis. But over the last year or so, we've been down a little bit, the last quarter particularly. So we need to sort of overcome those challenges. What struck me was that as the run-up to the elections and an interview that I saw of Prime Minister Modi, there were two words that actually resonated with me. One was confidence, and the second word was acceleration. So assuming that in Modi 2.0, we have the confidence because And I presume that even at that point of time, he wouldn't have known that he was going to get such a strong majority in the lower house. And with the upper house, Rajya Sabha, they're getting a majority in a short period of time. I think as far as legislative amendments are concerned, this is the right kind of an infrastructure and ecosystem available for the government to move ahead with the legislative amendments wherever it is necessary, as long as the intent and the confidence is there. Having said that, there are a slew of issues, obviously, that must be weighing very heavily on the Prime Minister's mind and his government. The first is the important element about the job situation. That is something that we need to sort of move forward with. The second is, how do we get our agriculture really up in the mainstream and make it far more productive and efficient? The third is to get manufacturing and industrial production. Services sector is already doing quite well. So if you look at the basic job creation, agriculture, industrial production and manufacturing, if we can get these three pieces sort of running in, I think we'll be able to sort of get back on the strong growth momentum. There are the usual issues about land and labor, as sort of two elements that the government will try and address as to what needs to be done. There's obviously a lot of, it is politically contentious, and I'm quite sure the government will find the right way forward on the land and labor reforms. To pump prime the economy, we also need a very strong financial system. So that becomes absolutely critical. How do we get back into supporting infrastructure growth, which was happening several years ago, but has slowed down in the recent past? How do we set up large manufacturing facilities? Who's going to finance it? I'll first take the issue of infrastructure. I think the infrastructure slowed down incrementally is when there were, number one, financing issues and also policy-related issues, which sort of impeded new incremental financing going into infrastructure. Many of those policy issues relating to infrastructure over a period of time have been addressed. Now it's a question of getting the financial system to back it. We don't have DFIs, development financial institutions. The banks have to take the responsibility till the possibly some DFIs can come back to finance. So which means that we need to address the issue of asset and liabilities. Banks have typically medium tenor liabilities, so if they need to finance infrastructure, they need to have long-term liabilities. Can we look at long-term tax-free bonds for banks to raise so that they can use those resources to sort of finance infrastructure? So we've got to think out of the box, far more creative than ever before, to be able to sort of get back into that economic growth that we need to have to be able to sustain an environment which is reasonably satisfied with their own personal lives. And there is a happiness quotient that sort of comes back into India over the next 5 to 10 years, which is where we will eventually determine how happy are our people. And I think those are the kind of issues, but I'm happy to get into more detail in any of these.
So you talked about 7 to 8% growth. There is a million-dollar question that comes up: is that 7 to 8% growth enough? Because when we look at jobs, and you alluded to that, jobs are certainly in need of our economy. And if about 12 million people are getting into the workforce each year, you know, you require 12 million jobs each year. Is 7 to 8% growth enough to create 12 million jobs per annum, or it has to be more than 10% kind of a growth for the next 5 years?
So, you know, Akhil, eventually our goal should be double-digit GDP growth. But to get to double-digit, you have to still cross the high single digits. So if you can get into a sustainable 8% GDP growth and create the right ecosystem, that will then catapult us to a higher growth from there. But if we do not look at solutions that allow us to move to a sustainable 8% GDP growth, I think 10% becomes only aspirational. So we have to be very pragmatic. At what pace do we get the changes in, and what is actually implementable in the system? You know, that's what I feel. So, yes, aspirationally 10% to be able to get the jobs created for all is there. We have been looking at it from the point of view of where will the jobs come from? As far as agriculture is concerned, if we bring efficiency in agriculture, it's actually going to reduce the number of jobs. So which means that if you look at urban centers, they are going to get far more crowded than ever before, which means that we need to create not just the major metro cities, but also smaller towns which are able to absorb this migration that is taking place. In Modi 1.0, he had sort of spoken about the 100 smart cities. Right. We need to sit back and think what truly happened or didn't happen in that plan to get to those 100 smart cities. And then learn from there and say, fine, if some things didn't work, now we've got to fix this and move into those 100 smart cities. Create the basic infrastructure that is required to be created there to enable that migration for young, aspirational India to come in and sort of play a role in those cities itself. The skilling is one of the most important pieces that are there for them to be able to get productive employment. How do we create good quality skills? You know, we can actually be a bit disdainful of what has happened on skilling over the last several years. I think that's not the right way to look at it. There has been skill development. It's a question of their placements have not been there. So we've got, you know, earlier we used to have, if you recall, those ITIs. Those ITIs were very good institutions for vocational training.
Right.
it worked in a very different environment. If it worked then, what is the new model of an ITI that can be created? It was small, it wasn't a big mega thing, it was in the vicinity of where the people were. So, and you know, you can sort of develop those. And so look at the Indian banking system. It's one of the most widely, the Indian postal and banking system has a distribution right across the country. In the public sector banking system, at least, they have created the regional centers which allow skill development to take place. We now need to see how successfully they're being run. It's not just a question of numbers. They are able to then provide the financing. People who graduate from those are able, we can provide them financing because under the new Mudra and the MSME funding, the 59-minute scheme that has come up with, what people have, so they need to be self-employed as well. You know, they can set up their own little unit. So I think it's a problem of such a magnitude that it cannot be one size fits all. It has to be disaggregated. It just cannot be sitting in the Niti Aayog. It has to go down and then disaggregated, and you've got to look at solutions. You've got to give people targets that this is what you have to achieve. On the sanitation side, we've been successful. If that has succeeded, I don't see a reason as to why we cannot succeed on this side as well. You know, on the skill enhancement, skill developments, young youth being sort of doing their own little, they don't need to go into an get employed in a large factory. They need to be far more entrepreneurial and do whatever is required to be done. So it's a mix of all of these elements that needs to be sort of worked together. And I'll come back to where I come from, the field of financial infrastructure. This is something that we need to make it far more contemporary. We've had some legacy issues on our financial infrastructure, but we need to overcome those, address the legacy issues. You know, the Sashakt Committee came up with the recommendations for resolution of those $200 billion equivalent of stress assets. The IBC has been a great success, but it has only so much of capacity that needs to be done. So we've got to take care of the legacy issues and then move forward. And I think there again, the financial architecture or the infrastructure that we need to, the ecosystem that we build is really something that is going to help pump prime the economy. The last piece is our regulatory infrastructure. Our institutional, our hard infrastructure can only be as strong as our soft infrastructure. If our institutional infrastructure, our institutions are much more stronger and robust, our regulatory architecture is far more robust, I think our hard infrastructure will succeed from there as well. So that's another area that I think needs to be addressed.
But one thing which I am noting from this discussion is while there are huge opportunities in India, but there is a lot to be done.
Yes.
In our small discussion, we have actually picked up about 15 areas, and I'm sure there are even more which need to be dealt with. So whether it's regulatory, whether it's skilling, whether it's financial system, agriculture, manufacturing, there is a lot to be done. And I think we should just look forward to better India getting built in next 3 to 5 years, which will be a great platform for decades to come. So
I'll just make one last point before you conclude. You're absolutely right in the conclusion. But I think the responsibility lies with all of us. We don't have to be just armchair critiques now of somebody else has to do this. I would say that all of us have to participate in this and roll up our sleeves and in our little way contribute to the development, you know, with our own professional capacities. I'm an eternal optimist that we have a problem, we have to deal with the problem, and we have to deal with it collectively, and we will be able to forge forward to ensure that what you said at the right time to achieve our double-digit GDP growth.
I can't agree with you more. I am also a die-hard optimist. And that's what I'm looking forward to, that we will do these right things and India will be on the right path.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Akhil.